to obey the commandments of the Lord. And that is still true today. Now, many church people have changed the word being the most important thing. And what is most important is praise and worship. It's like, if you can praise God, if you can dance a dance, if you can speak in tongues, you're good. And that is not what is most important to God. The word in us and our obedience to the word of God, because we love him, is what is most important. So some of these next chapters are kind of short, which is good. And we'll be getting right now, he's still giving them rules about once they cross over, or things that God wants them to do. A little later, which won't take us too long, we're going to get to some very interesting chapters, like what Israel could and could not eat, and some of the commandments that God gave concerning the way we dress. All of those things we are going to find and see where those words come from and what it means for us today. Okay, so, now what did I do with the... We will not read all of this because, as I said before, in the book of Deuteronomy, there is a lot of repetition. More than any other book in the Bible, I believe. Because Moses is not only repeating everything that was given since God started speaking to them in Exodus, but he's also reviewing what happened once they were delivered from Egypt. He's going over these things again and again and again to make sure they don't forget, okay? So, I'm going to read Deuteronomy 9, verses 1 and 2 first. Now, sometimes when we don't read all of the verses, but during the week, you go back and read the whole thing. I'm trying to pick out the most important ones. Sometimes it's repetition, but most of the time I'm pulling out what wasn't said in the earlier place. And I'm trying, yeah. Okay, that's why it's important not to miss Bible study, because sometimes it leaves little holes in your book, in your head, you know? I'm sorry? Yes. Yeah, he's repeating, yeah. The last book he wrote, and some believe, well, they have to believe, I mean, this is probably true, the last chapter in this book was probably written by Joshua, because it's about Moses' death, so we are assuming that he didn't write about his death after he died. Okay? All right, so, chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. Hear, O Israel, I stop right here. God keep saying that, right? Hear, O Israel. That was how he addressed them when he was telling them about the oneness of God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, right? So here he's saying it again, and we know that hear means going in the ear, into the mind and the heart, and then working itself out into our actions. That's the kind of hear. Not the kind of here where somebody's telling you something and you're doing something else and you're saying, mm-hmm. Are you listening to me? I heard you. What did I say? We weren't listening. We heard, but we weren't listening. We heard sounds, but it wasn't even getting down into us, right? Okay, so, hear, O Israel. Thou art to pass over Jordan this day, to go in to possess nations greater and mightier than thyself, cities great and fin- evidenced up to heaven, a people great and tall, the children of the Anakim, whom thou knowest, and of whom thou hast heard say, who can stand before the children of Anak? Now, what does this remind y'all of? These words that Moses is speaking right now. Yes, when they came back, when the spies came back. That's what they said, right? Now who's saying it? Moses. Moses is actually saying just about what the bad spies said, right? He's telling them that during the, when it says this day, thou art to pass over Jordan this day, it doesn't mean today, and it means in this period of time that we're here, you're going to pass over, okay? So, well, I'm going to get to that later. God is still reviewing the past of the nation Israel for this new generation. Their past wasn't good. So God didn't save them because they were good or outstanding, because they were not good and outstanding. God didn't save us because we're good or amazing or outstanding. And nobody else probably has ever felt this way. But when God saved me, I thought that God was lucky to have me. I was like, yay, God, I'm with you. I know you're glad. I mean, I can sing, I've been a Sunday school teacher, a youth choir director. I've done this, and I know I just can be an asset. What a fool I was, huh, guys? God, the only kind of people God is saving is bad people. When people come to Jesus, it's because they have realized that without him, they're nothing. They realize that they are sinners. They realize they need a savior. So God saves us because we're bad and need a savior. Because when you think about it, even our righteousness is nothing but a what? Filthy rag. And we know what kind of filthy rag you're talking about. Right? Everybody know? No? Anybody know? Brother Gary? You just don't want to say it? But it's really a filthy rag. Anybody know? Aaliyah? You don't want to say it either? Huh? Yes. It is a menstrual cloth here. That's how filthy our righteousness is on a good day. For the fifth time since we started Deuteronomy, Moses is saying, hear, O Israel. And I think the word hear is used in Deuteronomy over 50 times. And that here, and them believing God and moving by faith. And remember that the faith chapter in Hebrews 11 is all about the faith of those patriarchs in the Old Testament, right? That is the New Testament chapter on faith, giving us examples of them in the Old Testament. So, I think it's Romans 10 and 17, that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So again, in going over the word to them, he's telling them they need to obey God. And that they should never forget that they need to obey God. Obedience out of love is the key to every blessing that God gives us. And it's okay to repeat, to repeat, to repeat, to repeat. You can't ever get enough of hearing the word. I've been saved. Church anniversary. This year is 49. Next year it'll be 50. Tiffany, you got filled with the Holy Ghost when you were 6? Tiffany in here. Oh, okay. I think she's 50. I'll see when it comes in. But Tiffany was saved before I was saved. But it's somewhere between 45 and 50 years. I have never gotten tired of this book. I love this book. I love this book. But anyway, repeating truth. Sometimes we feel like if we keep repeating truths or keep repeating warnings, and we feel like we've beaten people over the head with the Bible. But here we see that it is okay to beat people over the head. But to repeat the truths of God over and over and over again. That's why we need to be taught. We need to come to everything that's Oh, I'm sorry. Philippians 3 and 1. He says, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord to write the same things to you. To me indeed is not grievous, but for you it is safe." What he's saying there is, it's not a problem for me to write the same things to you. It's okay. It's not grievous. It's not hard. It's not something I don't want to do. He said, but for you it is safe. It's good for you, for me to repeat. It's good for me to keep saying it over and over again. It's good for you. It's good for you to keep hearing the word over and over and over again. One of the reasons is because everybody doesn't get it the first time. I know I understand things so much better now than I did when I first heard the gospel. Because, and I am by no means throwing shade on anybody. I love all of the people at Pleasant Green because that was my family church, my family and their cousins and all of them. They're my grandfather's cousins and aunts and uncles started that church. And so I was really raised in church, but I didn't know anything about God. I mean, we had to go to church every Sunday. We had to go to Sunday school. We had to go to the Wednesday youth meetings. And I had to help my grandfather because he couldn't read. So I helped my grandfather so he could teach BTU. Some people used to call it the BYPU, something like that. And he would teach that, and I would read for him, and he is the person who gave me a love for the Word of God, because what I did read was a great big book of Bible stories all the time. But I didn't know God. I did not have a personal relationship with God. I did not know God and Jesus was the same person. And I didn't know if a book of the Bible didn't have a story in it, I didn't know that book. Because all I read was stories in the Bible. It had to have a plot. You know? So I did not really get it. And it took time for me to understand. And I'm sure that's the same for all of you. And it's best for everybody to come, if you can, to anything that's being taught. Here. Don't go nowhere else. Don't mess you up. Okay? Tiffany, you were 6 when you got filled with the Holy Ghost, right? And how old are you now? I'm just trying to figure out when I got saved. You think so? You don't know? I don't know. Okay. Okay. What is 48? Or 48 years I've been saved. Okay. So, what God says to them is, you're going in to possess nations that are greater than you, that are mightier than you. The cities are going to be great, big cities, and they're going to have walls so high you think they touch in heaven. So the people, big and tall, the children of the Anakim, which were giants, right? So y'all know them. You've seen them before. So, what, as Brother Randy said, it sounds like the words of the 10 spies who came back. God is really saying they too big for y'all. It's too hard for y'all. These people mightier, greater than you. So in essence, God was saying to him, I'm bringing you to possess something that's too big for you to do. You ever felt like God was bringing you to do something that was too big for you? He told them, it's too big for you. So God is calling them to enter into a seemingly impossible battle. I think that after I would have heard God say that, I would have just sat down in the sand. You're telling me to go, but you're telling me I can't win. You know what he's saying? The point is that there was no way that Israel could do this in the flesh. There was no way that Israel could do this in their own strength. God commanded his people to do something which was beyond their ability to do. They could not do it. But what God was saying is, you can't do it, but I can do it. And if you let me, by obeying me, I will work in you and I will work through you. Philippians 2:12-13. Philippians 2:12-13 says, wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. God in us can help us to work out our own soul salvation, but anything else, if you think you can't do it, if you think it's impossible, the old song again, huh? Do you have any problems that you think that you can't solve? Do you have any mountains that you can't tunnel through? God specializes in things impossible, right? He does. He can do the most impossible things. And I also have Proverbs here. Proverbs 21 and 31. 21 and 31 says, the horse is prepared against the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord. And you can have everything you want for the battle, but if God is not in it, remind you of David, I don't need your armor. I go in the name of the Lord. Anything we attack with the name of the Lord, we are victorious before we even start. Yes, our safety is in the Lord. We need to let God work in us for victory. Now, Deuteronomy chapter 9, verse 3. Understand therefore this day that the Lord thy God is he which goeth over before thee. As a consuming fire, he shall destroy them, and he shall bring them down before thy face. So shalt thou drive them out and destroy them quickly, as the Lord has said unto thee. I want you to understand. Just as much as Israel had to understand the impossibility of a battle on their own that they could win, they also needed to understand the certainty of the victory in the Lord. We need to know we can't do it. He has to do it in us. The job is impossible without him. John 15 and 5 says, he that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Wow. Do we really believe that? Do we think about it, or do we just think we can do everything on our own? Do we give God that gratitude and that honor and the glory for what happens in our lives, knowing that without him, we can't do anything? Again, we have Philippians 4 and 13. This time, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's how we get things done. We do it through Christ, right? So God is saying, he is going to destroy them, but you are going to drive them out and destroy them. So he's actually calling a partnership between himself and Israel. The battles that we fight should be a partnership between God and us. We can't do it on our own, but we have to do something, right? He also said at the end of verse 3 that they were to destroy them. First, he was going through like a consuming fire. then they were supposed to destroy, bring them down, drive them out, and destroy them quickly. Have no mercy upon them. Israel was to be an army of judgment against the Canaanites and their culture. We spoke about some of this in some of the other chapters. They deserved this judgment because God told Abraham that their iniquity was not full. So he waited all those years, giving them a chance to repent. They still have not repented, and God is sending judgment against the Canaanites through Israel. It was so depraved in Canaan that they deserved this kind of judgment. And when I think about it, all of these people mentioned in the Bible who are fighting all the time, their descendants are still over there fighting. Fighting about religion, fighting about culture. Now, the primary focus of the Canaanites was their religion. And the focus of their religion was sex. Those idols that were recovered by archaeologists found hundreds of nude female forms in all kinds of sexual positions. The idols, the statues. Now you see, when you go in some churches, you see the women with, you know, they are fully clothed. They have, but they found these were unclothed and in, they were carved in sexual and sensual positions. So, and there were men as well who were homosexuals. All of this is what was found buried under the sands when archaeologists dug. And so in these religious temples, this is what they found from the Canaanites. They had orgies for church service. They were horrible, horrible people. Also, there was bestiality involved as well. So God had waited and waited for these people to repent. Because, see, you don't even need a preacher. Because God will send somebody to you, or he will speak to you. You don't need to send them. Everybody on earth can hear from God. Or you can just look at the sky and know God is real. So it's time to bring judgment upon Israel. Deuteronomy 4 through 6. Speak not thou in thine heart after that the Lord thy God has cast thee out from before thee, saying, for my righteousness the Lord hath brought me in to possess this land. But for the wickedness of these nations, the Lord doth drive them out from before thee. Not for thy righteousness, or for the uprightness of thine heart, dost thou go to possess their land. But for the wickedness of these nations, for the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee, and that he may perform the word which the Lord sware unto thy fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Understand, therefore, that the Lord thy God giveth thee not this good land to possess it for thy righteousness. For thou art a stiff-necked people. See, God is blunt, and God tell you the truth for real, for real. Thou thinkest too much of thyself. You see, the temptation to pride can come into our spiritual beings. And long before you say it is because of my righteousness, long before you say it out loud, you're saying it in your heart. This happened because I'm righteous. This happened because I'm good. So they might begin to think, once they were conquering the territory and all that, that God had done this for them because they deserved it. But God said to them, you are just like a rebellious domestic animal. You'll stiffen your neck against the yoke that God will put upon you. And that is what we do. We don't want to obey. When we don't obey, we are like an animal with a yoke. Stiff neck. God trying to chase them. Trying to make, you know, your child might have their face turned. You're fussing at them. And you get them and you start pushing. Look at me. That's how God got to do his people. You don't want to turn and look at him. You don't look that way. Or as my son Angelo used to do. He didn't want to hear because they knew the scripture said you're hell for what you hear. So he said if he didn't hear it, he wasn't going to be hell. Negro, yes you are. Don't want to be like that though. But there's so much of that going on right now, especially in the next generation, where what you hear is what they think. They will tell you, I don't think God worrying about that. I think God got something better to be doing. They don't, if it's what they consider little, it doesn't matter what the words say. They're going to do it anyway. Because they're going to tell you, I ain't doing nothing wrong. Bruh, you're not saved. Something wrong if you're not saved. Because you're going to hell if you're not saved. I don't care who you are. I don't care whose son you are. I don't care whose daughter you are. I don't care how much love you have around you. If you are not saved, you are not going to spend eternity with Jesus. So, telling them, be careful that you don't get to thinking you so righteous, even once you do the right thing, that I did this for y'all because you're righteous. I didn't do this for you because you're righteous, because you're not. You're a stiff-necked people. He said, for thou art a stiff-necked or a stubborn people. He said, I'm doing it not because of your righteousness, but because of their unrighteousness. I will use you to destroy them. But it's not because you did anything so good or so great. Verse 7 of Deuteronomy 9. Remember, he has used this phrase before. Remember and forget not. Remember, remember, remember. Remember the old paths. Remember the old ways. God doesn't need anything new. Because whatever he has established is for yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't need our ideas to make his gospel more palatable. Because because that is what people are doing today. They're making the gospel easier to digest. They're making it taste better. Remember and forget not how thou provokest the Lord thy God to wrath in the wilderness, from the day that thou didst depart out of the land of Egypt until ye came into this place, ye have been rebellious against the Lord. You've been rebellious. Since you left Egypt, all y'all did was be stubborn and disobedient. You've been rebellious over and over and over again. First Corinthians 10 and 12 says, wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. Don't think you're all that. Don't think you're so righteous. Look at yourself and ask, where are you in the faith? Now, verses 8 through 21, I will discuss, but we will not read all of it. I'm going to read some of it. So first, I'm going to read verses 9 through 11. Then I'll tell you where I'm going from there. So 9 through 11. Because what is happening here is Moses is telling them he's repeating some of their worst rebellions to them again. When I was gone up into the mount to receive the tables of stone, even the tables of the covenant, which the Lord made with you, then I abode in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. I neither did eat bread nor drink water. And the Lord delivered unto me two tablets of stone written with the finger of God. And on them was written according to all the words which the Lord spake with you in the mount, out of the midst of the fire in the assembly. And it came to pass at the end of 40 days and 40 nights that the Lord gave me the two tables of stone, even the tables of the covenant. Then we go to verse 17. And I took the two tables and cast them out of my two hands and brake them before your eyes. And I fell down before the Lord as at the first, 40 days and 40 nights. I did neither eat bread nor drink water, because of all your sins which ye sinned in doing wickedly in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. For I was afraid of the anger and hot displeasure wherewith the Lord was wroth against you to destroy you. But the Lord hearkened unto me at that time also. And then verse 29. Yet they are thy people. 25. Thus I fell down before the Lord 40 days and 40 nights, as I fell down at the first, because the Lord had said he would destroy you. He's recalling the events at Mount Sinai, where they had worshipped that golden calf. So that's parts that we did not read. But I would like somebody to tell me if they heard anything that they didn't know in those verses I just read. Did you see something that you didn't know? Yeah, usually, because it's not in Exodus where he fasted for those 40 days and 40 nights, right? We find that out here. What else is there? We knew he fell on his face. Okay. What it is, listen, I'm going to go back to verse 18, And I fell down before the Lord as at the first, 40 days and 40 nights. I did neither eat bread nor drink water. Y'all looking at it? Do you see the phrase, as at the first? That means that he went into the mount a second time, 40 days and 40 nights, and fasted. So altogether it was 80 days. He went up to get the first tablets, and afterward he had, and after he came down and saw what they had done and broke the tablets, he had to go back up for another 40 days. He was begging the Lord not to destroy Israel. So God had never shown that to me until this year. Huh? Yeah. Fasting. No food, no water. He said, I went back up just like I did the first time. Yes. He cared that much for his people. Yes. That's how Sister Ann carried us. He did? Oh, how far had he gotten? I didn't know that. See, I didn't even know that. But you guys used to do, was it 40 here? Often, yes. Yeah, y'all got what? Maybe that's why y'all have such a wonderful marriage. For real. Y'all, they have a wonderful marriage. Because I don't know, Gary might go home at night and be poor Roz, I don't know. But from what I can see, yeah, if you want to look at and it's not the only one, but one of the best marriages. She beats him. Okay, Brother Randy, it's the other way around. Okay. So, you know, we find out a lot of stuff if we really, really read, and God reveals things to us, right? Because we see that is what happened. So, trying to see. I'm not. So God is showing us what Moses is doing, is showing them how faithful God has been to them and how really they haven't done anything to deserve that. When did God save us? While we were yet sinners, stiff-necked, rebellious, no count, arrogant, he saved us while we were yet sinners. He didn't wait for us to get good. I was talking to somebody about coming to church. And that person said to me, well, I gotta stop doing a few things first. Really? You want to get clean before you take a bath? That makes no sense to me, right? You take the bath to get clean, right? Stop saying what you need to do. And stop always talking about what you know. Because I can tell you this, the older I get and the more The longer I've stayed in the Lord, I have learned how little I know. And what a joy it is to learn more of God from all of you. We teach each other all the time. I enjoy those Thursdays so much. Everyone has given me nuggets of gold. You don't have to have a title or a position to speak and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. You just need to know him. Last scripture, Psalms 103 and 10. Well, actually, I'm going to start at verse 6. 103 and 6. The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sin, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. What a great God. He has not dealt with us according to what we've done wrong. He saved us while we were yet sinners, but he hasn't given us what we deserve. And that's called mercy. Because if he gave us what we deserve, we'd all be dead. None of us have gotten so good yet. Only will be when he comes back and we become like him. But I think that is such a beautiful scripture. He hasn't punished us according to what we've done wrong. I wish that tonight everybody, well, this week, that we think about those things, that of how good God is to us and how he died for us while we were still sinners, while we were in the illegitimate beds and in the juke joints and the crack house and the all of those things. And he saved us. Looking at us doing all that. He had our names written waiting for us to come to him. Next week, we're going to continue with chapter 10. Any questions or comments?